Jazz is a genre that very much praises personal expression, and it is in turn shaped by those individuals. One such individual who is often overlooked in the academic world is alto sax player Cannonball Adderley. He played a large part in bridging the gap between the audience and the music in a larger way than he is often given credit for. Julian Cannonball Adderley rose to prominence in the late 1950s and was on the forefront of the hard bop movement as well as a spokesperson for African American musicians. He was able to connect with audiences in a way that no other jazz musician ever had, thanks to his spirited personality and his passion for education. He made jazz accessible to an entirely new group of listeners through his high energy and interactive performances, and made great strides in growing the genre as a whole at a time when it was beginning to lose interest with audiences.
Well, we've just been enjoying a fascinating and instructive lecture demonstration by Cannonball Adderley. And I think that Cannonball is a living personification of the articulate jazz musician. Of course, he has an advantage over some in that he has actually been a teacher in schools himself, and he shows this experience when he talks to us on this program, as he does when he talks to the audiences at nightclubs and concerts.
Cannonball had a passion for teaching throughout his entire career, and in fact began his career as a band director. Fluent in multiple instruments, including trumpet, flute, clarinet, and tenor and alto saxophone, Adderley was able to connect easily with his students, offering witty yet educational mini-lectures that he would continue to give to his audiences.
Now, as I said before, the first eight bars of that tune didn't resolve as normal blues tunes do. This time, the first eight bars does resolve, but instead of resolving conventionally, it starts off unconventionally.
He never lost his passion for teaching, though, often going into depth about the music in interviews to help the audience understand it better, and putting on workshops at community centers, colleges, and high schools for the majority of his career. He also narrated an album called A Child's Introduction to Jazz that was almost spun off into a television show to rival Bernstein's Young People's Concerts.
You have just heard two very different sounding examples of the American music called jazz. This record is concerned with telling you and letting you hear something about what jazz is.
Cannonball's goal was not only to spread knowledge about jazz, but also the joy of it. He was a captivating showman, and had many trademarks that the audience ate up, like his signature snapping dance move. One such trademark that I believe had the biggest impact were the monologues that became a staple of his live performances.
I've been trying to figure out a long time what this name means for this tune that Victor Feldman wrote for us. This one is called Azul Serape. Now, he's from England, and I know it's not English. It's something else. Azul Serape. That's what the next tune is.
He would introduce the tune, the origin of the name, who wrote it, and other fun facts or anecdotes, of course injecting his unique wit into everything. Audiences weren't often addressed this way, especially by a jazz musician. During his residency at the club in Chicago, small pairs of drumsticks were passed out to the audience one night. Cannonball gave them a crash course on the rhythms they should play, and the audience can be heard banging on tables, glasses, and anything else in reach. This was such a contrast to other musicians of the day. My favorite example is Charles Mingus's live album, Charles Mingus Presents Charles Mingus, which opens with him telling the audience,
"We are interrupted by your noise. In fact, don't even take any drinks or no cash register ringing, etc."
Cannonball always tried to play what his audience would want, even if that meant butting heads with the record companies. His first recorded monologue, an intro to the tune Dis Here, was going to be cut from the release, and was only saved by producer Orrin Keepnews against the wishes of even the owner of Riverside Records.
Now we're going to play this by Bobby Timmons. It's really called This Here. However, for reasons of soul and description, we have corrupted it to become Dish Here. So that's the name, Dish Here.
On his next label, Capitol Records, they didn't release the tunes they recorded at the club where the audience was given drumsticks, including Money in the Pocket and The Sticks. It wasn't until the 2005 reissue, long after Cannonball's death, that we got to hear these recordings. One tune that connected with audiences like no other was Mercy, Mercy, Mercy.
Sometimes we're not prepared for adversity. When it happens, sometimes we're caught short. We don't know exactly how to handle it when it comes up. Sometimes we don't know just what to do when adversity takes over. And I have advice for all of us. I got it from our pianist, Joe Zavinu, who wrote this tune. And it sounds like what you're supposed to say when you have that kind of problem. It's called Mercy, Mercy, Mercy.
Although seemingly a simple and lighthearted tune, it was actually written by pianist Joe Zawinul as a musical expression of African American struggle for equality. Cannonball was an outspoken activist for civil rights, particularly that of musicians. Mercy, Mercy, Mercy was released on the album Live at the Club, although the entire session was actually a mock live performance recorded at Capitol Towers in Los Angeles. When it premiered on the radio, it was played 7 times consecutively by popular African-American disc jockey and civil rights activist, the Magnificent Montague. The tune was a plea to soothe the turmoil in the United States at the time, and it resonated with people. By the middle of the year, the single had sold 750,000 copies, with the LP selling 200,000. An unheard number for a jazz LP at that time. It hit number 2 on the soul charts and number 11 on the Billboard Hot 100, and also served the purpose of being a gateway for many listeners into jazz. There have been few jazz musicians that connected with the audience the way Cannonball Adderley did, and even fewer who enjoyed it as much as he did. His unique approach to including the audience in performances with his signature monologues, dances, and audience participation were hallmarks of this. And he made it clear that his goal as a musician was to make music that people would enjoy. He had a passion for teaching, whether that be his high school band classes or the audience at the club he was playing at. He strove to make the music accessible, particularly to black audiences, and did his best to encourage other musicians to live their lives the best way possible. His goal above all else seemed to be to once again make jazz a music that people could dance to, celebrate, and simply enjoy.